We're going to continue on with our next speaker, who is Professor Gretchen Hofmann from the Department of Ecology, Evolution, and Marine Biology at the University of California, Santa Barbara, and who will be talking a little bit more about the impacts and also not just the resilience of these organisms, but perhaps how they may be able to adapt to the changes they're experiencing.
I would like to thank the organizers. Happy to be here. Oops, here you go. Got it. And my job today was to talk to you a little bit more about how organisms will respond to this stress of ocean acidification. And what I wanted to do for you all was to highlight a new direction that we're headed. We've got a lot of new data, and I wanted to highlight the adaptive capacity of these organisms that we've been talking about. And Anne just highlighted for you a really important trait that ocean acidification will affect in marine biota, calcification. That's a functional trait. Its breathability and flexibility is determined by that organism's physiology. And underlying that physiology is genetics. And so eventually, we're going to talk about evolution. So hold on to your seats. And what I want to do is take you through a walk of what I've learned working with wonderful people like Richard Feely and Ann Cohen over the last 5 years. And the thing that's most important to know is that there's a little message of hope here, that I think that we can develop research strategies and plans that allow us to ask important questions about critical species and get, in some cases, some good answers. So I'm going to start here just by saying that a friend did a quick search of the literature, and you can see from 2005 to 2011, there's been an explosion of publications in the ocean acidification literature. And I did this too, and I call it impactology, because we were all asking, ooh, when future oceans come along and are very different, what will happen to the physiology of these creatures? And so we were very interested in that with all the facilities that Richard showed you, and we've learned a lot. Most of the outcomes are negative, some of them are positive, depending upon what organism you're looking at. But an important part of this was a lot of the exposures in the lab were based upon IPCC atmospheric predictions that, oh, control is 380, because that's what we think the atmosphere is now, and it'll interface with the water and drive PCO2 in the water, and 1,000 or 1,100 is high, and that would match one of the worst-case scenario IPCC predictions. Well, we learned a lot about how things respond to ocean acidification in the laboratory, a little bit in the field, but at the end of the day, in about 2010, 2011, I really felt personally like the big question remained unanswered, that we did not know the capacity of organisms to truly adapt, to use genetic change, changes in their genome, so that there would be evolutionary rescue of certain populations. And I literally had to sort of retool the way my marine ecology physiology brain worked and recruited to my laboratory evolutionary biologists and population geneticists and colleagues who I conned into getting interested into this question. And recently, at the end, you'll see that we're putting out two papers right now that really tell us so much more than we knew about 2 years ago. So it's really a nice story. So the big question, can they adapt? Now, this isn't like, ooh, Gretchen's had this incredibly great idea, because the entire climate change biology community has been thinking about this. And if you want to read about it, there's a great paper by Terence Dawson that came out in 2011. And he defines this term called adaptive capacity. And that's kind of like everything lumped together. Physiological tolerances, ability to evolve, ability to migrate, like what does that organism have to change? And the science community has done everything you can imagine, looking at direct observations, climate modeling, population models, experimental manipulations across the planet to understand this. So people in terrestrial and aquatic ecosystems are thinking like this. In ocean acidification, we need to unify and head this way. And so my goal today is to show you the path that we've been on for the last couple of years to try to bridge that gap from impactology to the understanding of whether populations can truly adapt to change. I'll show you some new data on natural variability in the environment. It's truly a report out by me for a group of people who are working together, funded by the National Science Foundation and also by a multi-campus initiative from the University of California. So this is state money at work. I'm reporting out on a coast of California and the West Coast project. And at the end, I'm going to humbly offer that this might be a nice strategy for us to use in different places around the world, or certainly on the coast of California, because we're doing it. So this is kind of where I just left you. So much of the work that was going on in the laboratories was based on IPCC predictions. And if you're an environmental biologist, you kind of go, nah, the models are really important to us, but there's a lot of natural variability, and certainly kelp forests, coral reefs, and the Antarctic might not be like the open ocean. So a really important thing happened at some point in like 2009 or 2010. I met this guy, the incredibly handsome Professor Todd Merritts, who was an ocean engineer who, while a postdoc at Monterey Bay Aquarium Research Institute, worked with Ken Johnson to essentially MacGyver, and I literally use that term, I don't use it very often, but in this case he did. He took a Honeywell commercial Durafit pH electrode, stuck some batteries on it, a memory chip, and a circuit board, and he made an autonomous pH sensor. Shortcut is, people like me, who are not the incredibly awesome Dr. Richard Feely, who has buoys in the Bering Sea and all this instrumentation, knucklehead ecologists like me could go all over the world and deploy these things. So we have about, I don't know, a dozen instrumented sites in Santa Barbara. And with Todd's help, we started beta testing these things. He would build them for us, and we'd take them out to the environment. And this was the first snapshot that we got that all parts of the ocean are not created equal. Now, this may not be a surprise, but if we're asking important questions about organismal function, we should know their background, right? So here's a little shot from Moorea, French Polynesia coral reef, the Antarctic, where we do some work, and there's the Santa Barbara Channel in the kelp forest. And basically, you can see there's an incredible amount of variation. You know, my students love this one because it's so exciting for them to do. Here's the open ocean average around 8.1, the green line, and there's a sort of like worst case scenario, business as usual, IPCC projection. And what they like to say is that, you know, on any given Tuesday, our kelp forests are, you know, this low in terms of pH and PCO2. So tons of natural variability. Now, this alone is an interesting observation, but in the context of studying these animals and forecasting what's going to happen, it is critical because natural selection works, evolution works, and organisms are used to what they've been living in. And what they're used to, the selection regime that they've been under, is going to determine how well they are able to truly adapt to ocean acidification. Okay, so we must know the environment, and we're getting there. We're getting much better at it. So if natural selection works, I literally, during my own re-education, I organized a workshop of ocean scientists and evolutionary biologists. And this is kind of, I knew this, but I had to be reminded. The question we're asking when we go back here and we say, can things adapt to ocean acidification conditions? We're really asking, can rapid evolution happen? Because most of these organisms have been used to an environment that's been around for tens of thousands to millions of years, and we're asking them, will you be able to alter your genome and the way your body works in the face of a rapidly changing environment? And this, in the business of evolutionary biology, is called rapid evolution. So just quickly, in evolutionary biology, in that discipline, that subdiscipline, we know that this occurs. So here's one of our colleagues and neighbors, Dave Resnick, over at UC Riverside, and he's got possibly one of the best examples going on rapid evolution. It can occur rapidly and in short ecological time spans in this cute little Trinidadian guppy. They live in these ponds that are very close to each other, but there's a lot of different kind of selection going on in the ponds, and the guppies are genotypically different, showing that they've genetically changed over a very short period of time. And if you're interested in this, they have a totally cool The Guppy Project webpage that has tons of resources for how to think about this. So if that goes on in the field and rapid evolutionary change is possible in a metazoan like a fish, if we go into the laboratory, we can see that evolutionary rescue can occur, that it's been demonstrated in the field. So you can go out and find all sorts of examples, but here's one on brewer's yeast, where these guys took yeast, exposed them to really nasty, horrible salinity, that salt that started to kill them. But then over time, there are some genotypes in that culture that are okay, and they come back and they repopulate the tube. Now, this is a really simple example, but this is what we're talking about. There are genotypes out there in all populations we hypothesize that can withstand these conditions and, given the opportunity, can reproduce and pass on this resistant genotype to their progeny. And that's how evolution works. So we're really asking, will this occur within an ocean acidification construct? So where we're at then is really looking at a balance of physiological plasticity and the ability to do genetic change. So this is where you really have to start putting on your evolutionary biology caps, because the question is, how do you do this? How does one go about thinking about this? So rapid evolution, evolutionary change, requires really two things. It's kind of like grist for the evolutionary mill. If you're going to do it, you got to have this. Standing genetic variation, enough variation in your population, enough different genotypes, can't be all the same, that's bad, right? Or new mutations. New mutations can come along, change a gene, get a totally different answer. That could be important in the future. New mutations are really rare, and this is not something that you want to sit around and base your scientific career on, because this is going to be hard to find, expensive, and not very useful. But looking at things related to how variable is your population genetically is really important and can be done now. So I want to show you a couple ways in which the OA community and colleagues of mine and my laboratory have been looking at standing genetic variation in populations of marine organisms in response to ocean acidification and what we think the outcome might be. So the three strategies I'm going to describe to you are these. First, we're just going to, for a moment, remind ourselves about that balance of physiological tolerance and genetics. We're going to look at local adaptation as a way to look for hot spots of adaptation or even places of refuge to ocean acidification, something that the speaker following me, Elizabeth, is going to talk about. It's critical. And then breeding experiments. We've been doing this for a really long time as humans. This is how we got chihuahuas and cows that yield a lot of milk and corn. So this can be used, this technology can be used to understand these CO2 related problems. So let's start with this one, right? So there is some answer to be found out there. If we say that function comes from genotype, we already have some answers if you look in the literature. We know that there are strains of coccolithophores that behave better and differently, the same with oysters, as demonstrated by Laura Parker. And there are differences in performance in these encrusting bryozoans. Some things seem to have population variability, and they do better. They calcify better in the face of these changes. So there's already a hint that right now there are strains and stocks that are doing better. And how do we uncover that? How do we go in and query those organisms to find out if there's genetic differences? This one is for Bill. So there are genetic differences in congeneric oyster species. Not your guy, but it's true that we can see genetic differences between different species. So some of the genetic underpinnings of tolerances, here's the calcification profiles of an oyster, different oyster species against PCO2. We've already uncovered some of this. It's already there. So if we know that there's plasticity and response out there in the world, how do we go looking for it? And how do we find out if there's a genetic underpinning? Well, out there in sort of marine ecology, where observation has been key for hundreds of years, there's this thing called local adaptation. And this is a situation where you're actually letting Mother Nature help you. She has already created places of intense temperature versus cold. Or in Anne's case, maybe really warm temperatures and low temperatures and different PCO2s in the environment. So those variables already can be found. So local adaptation, by definition, is that you've got the fine-tuning of populations to their local environment via natural selection. So that local environment selecting, creating a kind of genotype. And in the OA world, I'm about to tell you the story, we hypothesize that existing and persistent variation creates the right conditions so that populations evolve different performances or phenotypes, and we can go looking for them. And we can literally ask now, are there places with lots of variability or really low pHs and another place with no variability where there are different genotypes? So in this system, we really said and asked ourselves, is there local adaptation to gradients in the ocean acidification seascape as we know it today? And this is kind of a critical way of thinking, because this mentality, if you co-locate your sensors with the biology, one will find places where there's very little variability. Those may be refuges of places to shield things from future acidification. If you find tons of variability with lots of different genotypes, who knows what? That could be a hot spot for adaptation. That's where your tolerant genotypes are going to come from. And maybe, in a lot of weird ways, we should be protecting really awful places, too, because that's where the selection is happening. So it kind of turns your, what do we protect? For me, anyway, in my pea brain, it turns my head around and, what should we be protecting? So the story I want to tell, after all that, is about a research group called the Omegas. We're a consortium of investigators spanning from Oregon down to UC Santa Barbara. And our core goal is to collate sensors with biology. And here we want to capture the ocean acidification mosaic on the coast and then look at the variability of populations, in this case right now, of benthic marine invertebrates like sea urchins and mussels and oysters and even calcifying algae in the face of this variation. And in our study, we've got right now 6 main sites. And at each of these sites, we've got onshore pH sensors and a whole bunch of stuff offshore. So we've got matching sensor places at each site in the network. And we were inspired literally by Richard Feely, because in 2008 he published a paper showing that there was this mosaic of upwelling conditions on the coast. In his talk, he showed you that those upwellings happened all summer. And we thought, we think we see a pattern where there might be hot spots for upwelling and therefore lower pH exposure than other places. We also had some data in the intertidal that said there was also such a situation. In 2012, a study spurred us on even more, saying that the coastal area, the California large marine ecosystem, or is it called the California coastal system, would really be subject to intense undersaturation in the near future. So we were even more riveted to do this project. So as I said, we instrumented our coast starting in about 2011. Sensors, the pH sensors on shore, deployments both on moorings, subsurface, and some benthic, some bolted right into the intertidal. And offshore, we've got an array of instrumentation that's recording everything from temperature, salinity, but critically, pH and PCO2, total CO2, so we can parameterize the carbonate system and know what the pH conditions are. And here's it's like the one slide wonder of oh my God, what's going on there? But now we have, they make me show this because the oceanographers are so proud of this, but at all these sites, we have tons and tons of data coming in from April to October now for 2 years running. This is the upwelling season on our coast. And if we just take a breather and zoom in on one thing that is critical for the biology, I'll just show you one thing. So up here's Fogarty Creek, that's our most northern site. And it's probably it's in Lincoln City, which might be 60 miles south of where Whiskey Creek is, Tillamook Hatchery. And down here is Lompoc Landing in the blue. And if one filters the data and organizes it so that over here I show you cumulative frequency of time that sensor spent picking up measurements below 7.7, and this down here is the temperature of the sensor, and what you'll note is that upwelled water is cold. All I'm really showing here right now is there is an incredible gradient. Fogarty Creek is so much different in upwelling intensity and therefore low pH exposure of those organisms that it's pretty amazing. If we change this filter, make it less rigorous, Strawberry Hill and Bodega Bay start to catch up. But basically, there's an incredible gradient where organisms in California are kind of wimpy. They're not used to a lot of low pH stress. They are locally adapted to less intense conditions. And up north, lots of upwelling, really intense low pH conditions. So right away, we had the physical data to tell us, and I'm shorthanding this so much that it's incredible, but we had the physical data to tell us that we had a mosaic of conditions in the field. So step 3 was to go out and do the biology, to go out and ask, are there genetic differences that we can identify in these populations? And furthermore, if we find out that there is, can we find some trait that's resistant to OA or something to look for, and then see if it's heritable? So what I'm going to show you now are the results of all these experiments. We zoomed in first on the purple sea urchin, which is an ecologically dominant species in the coastal regions where we live. And most importantly, for some of our purposes, there was a fully sequenced genome so that we could do a lot of this work early on, and it really aided us in our progress. But the larvae and the adult are calcium carbonate skeleton-building organisms, and the larvae in particular spend a lot of time, 3 to 6 weeks out in the water, sort of like little bioassays, making their skeletons while they bob around and feed. And the size of their bodies is like a direct indicator of their response to the local water condition. We knew from laboratory studies that if sea urchin larvae were raised at really low pHs or high pCO2s, they were small. Parts of their body started to change in size. So we had some inkling about the fact that this would be a great study system for us. So groups at Bodega Bay Marine Labs and our lab started culturing larvae in essentially pickle buckets, where we bubbled CO2 into them to create different pHs, different pCO2s. And the metric I'm going to show you here, the response variable, the trait, is basically the size of the larval body. So here's a sea urchin larvae. They're starting to grow their arms. And we can measure the length of all their little parts. They're sort of like a freestanding backpacking tent, where the body parts are like the aluminum tent poles, and the cells are like the tent that goes over it. So they're really discrete. You can see them under the microscope. And they're really important. That's their body. That's the skeleton they're making. So the first experiment that was done was just published by Melissa Pespini, who is a postdoc at Indiana University now, but did this work at Bodega and was also a PhD from Stanford. And she's the classic example of a young scientist coming in here and making hay, because she had the technical expertise to come in and use next generation sequencing techniques to answer these questions together with us. And so one thing I want to tell to everybody in the room here, one of our greatest resources right now are people. Training, multidisciplinary training, and recruiting others into these climate change related studies. So what Melissa showed, that there was a change in body size. So that's our trait, smaller body size. And really, we were wondering why this was occurring in buckets. But literally, the urchins were doing pretty well. And while you raise them, one of the questions that you're asking is there selection going on in that bucket? So when these experiments were done, tons of females gave up their eggs, and they were fertilized with sperm from a whole bunch of males. So it was like a lottery. Then everybody went in the bucket. Whee! And then they grew for like weeks and weeks and weeks. And at the end, we'd done a selection experiment. So at the end of the part of the selection experiment, we could see that, oh, there's been some change in body size. But at no time was there like really terrible outcomes. They still all developed. But what Melissa was able to do was to go in, extract DNA and RNA, and ask, are there changes in their gene frequency? Is there a selection experiment going on in that bucket, such that there are some genotypes that are doing better at this high pCO2 level? And the answer was yes. This is kind of hard to look at, but day 7 is the bar that goes out further, so that by the time they got out to day 7 incubation at 900 microatmospheres pCO2, there were really serious changes in the frequency of genes in the progeny of that big mass spawning. So we have here a microselection experiment where there are genotypes that did better. And that's what we want to know about. Is that going on in the environment? The answer is yes, because these all came from nature. So stay with me, because this is crazy, but this is so important that it just makes you just want to fall over, if you're me. So what we did, if you see that there's genetic variability, you should be able to go find it. Where is it, and how is it important? So we did this cross-design breeding experiment that Bill would be very familiar with, where you take males and females, and in this case, we did a Southern California and a way Northern California. They're very different in their exposure, so they're locally adapted to different pH conditions. And we did a cross design where Northern males were spawned to women, females from their neighborhood, and they were crossed with gals from not their neighborhood. So you have this cross design where you have crossing genotypes north to south, north to north, so you can see what's going on. We then did the same thing and generally found the same thing. If you just look at everybody at higher CO2, all the progeny were about 10% smaller. But if you spread it out by family, here's the average size. You can see that the families, depending upon their sire, just all 16 of them, were really different sizes. Percent decrease in size was really variable. Some of them didn't change at all. Some of them had really high impacts. And if you look at it like this, the outcome is that you see that it matters who your daddy is, because the genetic resistance to preserve your body size in the face of ocean acidification, to continue to calcify well, to not shrink, to be a larger larvae that can feed better in the water column, is dependent and linked to the northern sire, the genotype of the northern sire. And that was like, wow, that's really amazing. But Morgan, my postdoc, Morgan Kelly, went one step further, and she did a thing a population geneticist would do, and that's to calculate the heritability of retaining that body size. And Morgan said, Gretchen, it's the high CO2 sires, the heritability is 0.5. And I was like, great, I have no idea what that number means. Tell me more. So Morgan, this is literally was made for me. This is how bad it is. So she said, in American white males, height is really heritable. We all know families that have really tall guys or really short guys, and then it's pretty heritable. And she said in copepods, something I'm also familiar with and she works on, it's not very heritable. And those index numbers are 0.8 and 0.15. So she said a 0.5 is an insanely high number for a trait in a wild population. It is extremely heritable. And so here we have a trait that's incredibly important to larvae, trust me. That's incredibly heritable. There's genetic variability in nature. And so right away, you get this kind of summary where you go, wow. So here's the first example that I've been able to create where we have a situation that environmental heterogeneity, and the paper's in prep on that now, is selecting for organisms where in a population where there's enough genetic variability to produce resistant organisms, and it's heritable. So it's a little complicated to think about when you put it all together, but it really sets us up to look at it this way, right? So if you want to understand what's going on with organisms in nature, if we think about this in a global change biology way, understanding the environment is really critical because it acts on genotypes that have a certain kind of physiology that has been created by this environment-genotype interaction. But what we really want to know is in the future, as the environment changes, is adaptation possible? And we look for standing genetic variation and maybe use looking at local adaptation as a way to help. So I always think of this strategy as my worry of will there be sushi? Because I live in Santa Barbara where the red sea urchin divers bring up yummy, yummy red sea urchin all the time. And we use the roe in all sorts of cooking, including the sushi uni. But one way to look at this is it's an integrated strategy where we need to put all of this together at the same time, looking for genetic variation, looking at present day resilience and tolerance, because as Anne illustrated, it could be that there are populations out there that have the flexibility that can buy us time before we can get our act together and reduce CO2 emissions. Evolutionary rescue can also buy us time. But really importantly, we need to kind of collate that biology with sensors so we know what's going on in this interrelationship. And for Steve, who's maybe out in a conference call, this kind of thinking is part of the CCAN's core principles. I think Catherine mentioned it. It's a stakeholder group of aquaculture and wild fishery shellfish folks and scientists putting it together and saying, these are the things we need to really get to the answers that we really want. So with that, I'll end.